Well, it's definitely good being here again.
Amen.
On a Sabbath day. I'm starting a series, and my schedule is clear for a while, so I'll be able to share the whole series with you.
Amen.
In the coming months. And as we near the edge of eternity, you know, I ask the Lord, I don't like to even study anything that's going to waste my time. Mm-hmm. That's not going to be beneficial to me or help me out in changing my character. Mm-hmm. And so I don't like to share anything that I feel like that it's not going to be able to help you during the week. For we know church starts on Sunday, and it's from Sunday to Friday. Mm-hmm. Here is where we fellowship. Mm-hmm. So I'm starting a series called Monsters in the Closet. And like I said, this was to myself and to my wife and to my family. It started with us these past couple months. I've been trying, but God has been blessing and revealing to us the monsters in our closet. Mm-hmm. So today we're going to deal with part one of Monsters in the Closet, and that's Remission of Forgotten Doctrine. Mm-hmm. If you can pray with me.
Dear Heavenly Father, please, Lord, let me disappear, Lord, and let your Holy Spirit fill this place, Lord. Fill me up, Father, that you may reach whom you wish to reach, Lord, and help us to retain the things that we hear, Lord, that we may use them. Lord, we thank you for hearing our prayer. In your Son's precious name, we give it prayer. Amen.
Amen.
Remission. Forgotten Doctrine. How many of us here are used to hearing that word remission? Mm-hmm. Dealing with scripture. Let's go over the meaning. Is it recording?
Mm-hmm.
Is, you know, and I say the Forgotten Doctrine because remission isn't taught nowadays too much. I don't hear it too much anymore. And when I asked the Lord what should I talk about, and he brought to mind remission, and I got into the meaning of it, it blew me away that we're not being taught this thing that's called remission. Well, remission actually means forgiveness, deliverance, liberty, release from bondage, or imprisonment. Forgiveness or pardon of sins, letting them go as if they have never been committed. Remission of the penalty. And as our scripture verse read, let's take a look at it again. John 20. John 20, Jesus is speaking to the disciples here, and he's telling them, whosoever sins ye remit, they are remitted. And the reason I said that in dealing with the meaning of remissions, see, the first meanings of remission is how we're remitted from God. But right here, Jesus is telling the disciples they can remit others. So the meaning of remit, or should I say true forgiveness to someone else, is when you remit someone else, meaning you're truly forgiving them. Mm-hmm. And those meanings are passing over, to pass over, to let pass, to tolerate, or just to disregard. Somebody offends you, you just disregard it as if it never happened. And like I said, monsters in the closet. That was a monster in my closet.
Yeah.
I didn't know how to. I didn't realize till recently, and my wife will vouch for this, but I really didn't know how to forgive. I thought I was forgiven, but I wasn't forgiven. And I wasn't doing it God's way, the right way.
You're just getting by.
I was, call myself forgiven with conditions.
Yeah.
And when you forgive with conditions, you love with conditions.
Yes.
Turn to your Bibles. Let's go to Luke chapter 24. Luke chapter 24. I want to lay the groundwork before we really get into the bread of the sermon. But like I said, this was to me in my house first. And this was one of the things that I say the majority of Christians deal with nowadays. And I see why. I see why the devil doesn't want it taught. For we're going to deal with that first part of remission, when God offers you remission. And I know we're saying remission, but I like to make it practical. I'm basically talking about the guilt of the sin. The guilt of the sin. Not the sin itself, but the guilt that we may carry because of that sin. Luke 24, and I'm going to start at verse 47. It says, Luke 24, and I'm going to start at verse 47. And this is Jesus as he's leaving. You know, when you're about to leave and go away, and you're not going to see somebody for a while, and the last thing you tell them is probably one of the most important things that you want them to remember. He tells the disciples, and that repentance and remission of sins should be preached in his name among all nations, beginning at Jerusalem. And ye are witnesses of these things. And behold, I send the promise of my Father upon you, but tarry ye in the city of Jerusalem until ye be endued with power from on high. Now, go back up to 47. It says, and that repentance and remission. Now, see, that caught my eye months ago. That's what made me look into the word remission. I said, okay, because there's an and in there. So it's not only just repentance, but he says and remission. So that means there's something else. But a lot of times we hear repent, which is truly, you know, you hear somebody say repent, repent, repent. But I want to ask the question. Remission is the guilt of the sin. Now, repentance is you saying you'll stop and you'll turn away. But what's the use in stopping and turning away if you carrying the guilt with you when you turn away?
Amen.
That's right.
So then I started to see why the devil doesn't want remission taught. Because if I was the devil, I could take one stone, that one sin you committed, if I could take that one stone and kill you twice, I'm going to do it. And that's what he does. When you repent and you say, Father, I'm sorry, please forgive me, and you stop from doing what you're doing, but you carry that guilt with you, the devil's still right there with you. He's using that same sin to still knock you over the head with. When God already forgave you. So I started to see why this isn't being taught. And the more I got into it, the more I started to see it in the Word. I'm like, wow. So this is one of the things I'm making the foundation of my ministry, is to let people know. And to let, I had to, like I said, this started in my home just recently. We had to, and this was to let my wife know, to let me know, to let my kids know, hey, you don't have to carry the guilt of what you did around with you. You have been remitted. Or should we go through the meanings again? You have been set free. You are at liberty. You are free from imprisonment. You know what this thought just hit me? This ain't even one of us, but this thought just hit me. Could it be, when it says set free from imprisonment, what if it's your sin that got you in prison? But the guilt is the prison house itself. So when it says, when Christ says to teach, he's telling his disciples, we are to share and to teach people not only that they need to stop and turn away from their sins, but they no longer have to carry the guilt of their sins with them. That not only can you be set free out of the prison house, or your charges are dropped. Let's just say when, you know, I spent time incarcerated, when they come down and they tell you that your charges are dropped, the remission is now you can leave. You're set free. You no longer have to live with that guilt of your actions. And I say majority of Christians and majority of people, period, live with the guilt of their actions. But there's something about at the verse 49, we're still in Luke. At the very end of verse 49, it says, Jesus says, but tarry ye in the city of Jerusalem until ye be endued with power from on high. Until ye be endued with power from on high. And from our scripture in John, from our scripture, you don't have to turn there, only if you want to, John 20, back to John 20. Jesus said in verse 22, and when he had said this, he breathed on them and said unto them, receive ye the Holy Ghost. See, but the one thing about repentance and remission is nothing happens without the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Nothing happens without the Holy Spirit. So that let me know, okay, Christ said, stay still until the Holy Spirit comes into your life. And that let me know, how many times do we move or act without the Holy Spirit?
A lot.
I know I've moved many times, done it, especially dealing with my children, dealing in my home. I've acted and I've said many things without first making sure that I'm being guided by the Holy Spirit. So I wanted to make that, because that's a whole nother sermon in itself about waiting on the Holy Spirit before you act, before you say, and before you do things. And that's my biggest thing, especially being a teacher of the word. I can be loose with this right here. And once it's already out there, it's out there.
That's right.
Once it's already out there, it's out there. But Christ says, wait on the Holy Spirit before you act, before you go. So that also let me know that there can be no repentance and there can be no releasing of guilt without the Holy Spirit. Without the Holy Spirit. Let's go to Acts 2:38. What we're going to do right here is, I'm going to just show real quick, because I was baffled about how many times remission is actually mentioned in the Word. And how many times it's given as a command. So that's what we're going to do. We're going to call these remission verses right here. We're going to go through them. We're going to try to go through them real quick just to show how many times remission is right here in the four Gospels and in the Acts of the Apostles.
Acts what?
Acts 2, verse 38. Then Peter said unto them, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins. And ye shall receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. Now this one, when I read this one, you see where it says, and be ye baptized, repent and be ye baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ, for. Now that word for means repenting and being baptized. That word for is because this is what leads to. It's a conjunctive word. It means it leads to something else. What we just read is supposed to be the catalyst or leads to what's about to be said. So he said, repent and be baptized, and that's what we hear a lot, right? But the repent and be baptized is for, what's the next couple words? The remission of sins. And ye shall receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. There is the Holy Spirit again. Before. So repenting and being baptized is for the remission of sins. Or can we say it's for the release of guilt? Or like the meaning even says out of the Strong's, remission of the penalty. Release from the penalty of the sin. Because sometimes, I'm going to be honest with you, sometimes I've sinned, I've done some things, knew I wasn't supposed to do it, and I just be waiting on something bad to happen. Like, I know something bad going to happen. I know something bad going to happen. You know, even though I asked for forgiveness,
yes.
Even though I prayed for forgiveness, even though I was sincere, in the back of my head, I'm still thinking something is going to happen. Something bad is going to happen. I know it's going to happen. Why? And then they hit me, you know, we're dealing with a clever foe. There's a lot of principles of life that are not biblical, but we live by them anyway. And I'm telling you, a good exercise to do when you study or just when you're by yourself is go through certain principles and or little sayings that we live with that we throw at each other as if they're biblical, but they're not biblical at all. They're not biblical at all. Just for example, one of them is you can't help somebody until they help themselves. That's not true. God helped me when I wasn't helping myself. You know, there's a lot of little sayings like that that are not biblical. And the one we're going to deal with today that goes against remission is karma. What goes around
comes around.
That's not true if I've asked for forgiveness.
That's true.
If I sin, if I hurt somebody, but I'm actually forgiven. Now, there may be consequences that you might have to face from certain actions, but if you truly ask for forgiveness and you were sincere, God says you are forgiven. You are released from the penalty of that sin. what went around doesn't have to go around. But because I grew up with certain of these things, I've sinned. And like I said, I've been waiting on the lightning strike, something bad to happen. And so then I'm worried and living in fear because of my sin. There it is, the devil. Even though I've been forgiven by God, but the devil has used that same sin to still beat me over the head with, just in a different way, through my guilt. Through my guilt. How many of us are still dealing with guilt today? From past sins in our life. But let's see about this word remission. Like I said, we're gonna skim through the, I'm gonna call these remission verses. Go to Acts 10, turn to Acts 10. Acts 10, and I'm gonna read verse 43. Well, we're gonna read verse 42, we'll read verse 42. Acts 10, verse 42 says, "And he commanded us to preach unto the people and to testify." That word, he commanded. "And he commanded us to preach unto the people and to testify that it is he which was ordained of God to be all the prophets' witness, that through his name whosoever believeth in him shall receive remission of sins." Remission of sins. Could it be that Christ came to release us from the guilt that the sins may carry? Because he knows that if he can get you to carry that guilt, it's as if you've never been forgiven. Well, you will act as if you've never been forgiven. Let's keep going. Turn to Romans 3:25. And like I said, this was a blessing to me and my family, because we were still dealing with old sins, just beating us up over the head. Romans 3:25. "Whom God hath set forth to be a propitiation through faith in his blood, to declare his righteousness for the remission of sins that are past through the forbearance of God." Through the forbearance of God. Turn to Matthew 26. Let's go to Matthew 26. Matthew 26, and I'm going to read verse 28. Matter of fact, let's start at verse 27. Verse 27. It's the Last Supper. "And he took the cup and gave thanks and gave it to them, saying, drink ye all of it. For this is my blood of the New Testament, which is shed for many for the remission of sins." For the remissions of sins. Go to Mark 1:4. Go to Mark 1:4. I just wanna lay the foundation and prove a little point right here with these verses. Mark 1:4. John did baptize in the wilderness and preach the baptism of repentance for the remission of sins, for the remission of sins. Go to Luke 1. Go to Luke 1. Luke 1. Now I'm going to read verse 77. "To give knowledge of salvation unto his people by the remission of their sins." Let's read verse 76 to go with that verse. "And thou, child, shall be called the prophet of the highest." And this is Gabriel talking to Zacharias about John the Baptist. "And thou, child, shall be called the prophet of the highest, for thou shalt go before the face of the Lord to prepare his ways, to give knowledge of salvation unto his people by the remission of their sins." One more. Go to Luke 3. Go to Luke 3. We'll do one more. Go to Luke 3. Now this is dealing with the preaching of John. Luke 3, verse 3 says, "And he came into all the country about Jordan, preaching the baptism of repentance for the remission of sins." I wanted to prove a point. How many times did we see that baptism and repentance was for the purpose of releasing you from your guilt?
A lot.
because then you were set free. So even the more I studied, I said, why isn't this taught? Like I said, it made perfect sense to me. I call these the devil suitcases. Devil suitcases. You know, God has forgiven us, but we pack up all our dirt in these suitcases, and we carry them around with us. Carrying the devil suitcases, carrying the guilt from past sins, and God is sitting there looking, your guardian angel is sitting there looking, saying, you've been forgiven. Drop the suitcases.
Amen.
Sometimes God has forgiven us, even backpacks, even like children can carry them in little backpacks. And you know what I'm saying, you've been forgiven for the sin, but 2 days later, that sin just come out your little backpack, come up on your shoulder. Yeah, I remember what you did. You start feeling guilty all over again, like you just did it. Like you just did it. Like you did. Now why is God stressing remission? Don't muscles have memory? Could it be, and how our brain works, that if you dwell in the guilt of your sin, your body reacts as if you just did it? So like I said before, that one sin has beaten you up 3, 4, 5 more times. That one act that you've already been forgiven for. And most of us, and this is why I said this was, and like I said, I felt this was the one of the most, that's why I call it, this is the monster in the closet. This is one of the monsters in the closet. Because I feel like nowadays, being practical, for most of us carry guilt from our childhood, from what happened at home, school, mistakes we've made in life, regret. We still carrying these sins around with us in suitcases. Now we're supposed to be going somewhere. That's why I call them suitcases. You're supposed to be taking a trip, going somewhere. But can you get there if you're carrying suitcases? Well, if there's not enough room on the train for you and your suitcases? Guilt that we've been carrying our whole life. I know I carried guilt from school, stuff I did at home. And the thing about it dictates the way you act. It dictates the way you look at yourself. This old guilt. The devil's still laughing. He said, I ain't even gotta do nothing to him. The sin he committed 10 years ago is still beating him up. And what's so sad nowadays, through music and movies, and I know this because I used to listen to hip hop, things of that nature, but some people's guilt becomes a badge. Some of us look at our guilt as almost a badge, to where that become our excuse in life. Well, you know, this happened to me, and this happened to me, and this, I grew up without a family. You know? And it's easy for me to try to use that as a badge. He said, my family, you know, I grew up in the born and raised in the dope house. My grandma ran the dope house. So it's easy. So when I say I had a family, they were there, but they wasn't there, if you get what I'm saying. You know, I met every personality up under the sun before I was like 7 years old. You know, but and so many other things I've seen happen, eye to eye, I think, so much evil and wickedness I've seen firsthand. So I could have easily used that as a badge, or, you know, this is how I grew up. But through music, through movies nowadays, people use guilt and the horrible things in life as a badge. And so their guilt becomes like this shield to them. Well, you know, this is the reason I do this. You know, because I messed up over here, to where guilt, regret, all these things. You know, it's no longer even looked at as, you know, it becomes a crutch. It becomes your crutch. But I'm gonna be, you know, my wife will tell you, I'm very honest and I'm frank and I'm harsh. I'm harsh on myself. Can't nobody say nothing bad about me. I ain't said it 3 times already. I mean it, you know. Sometimes as humans, we think we forgive. But inwardly, we like to see those who wronged us wrestle with their guilt. Let me see if I explain that a little bit. People who've done us wrong, sometimes we don't want to just let them off the hook. You know, just, I forgive you, and they hook free. Sometimes we like to see them wobble in that guilt and feel sorry and things of that nature a little bit, Emily. And that's when I even had to realize, I really don't know how to forgive. Because there's a verse that says, how you forgive is how God forgives you. So if you make somebody wobble and enjoy the sin of their guilt, then God is going to cause you to wobble and lay in your guilt and your shame. Mm. Look, sometimes, well, and you see, like the scripture verse said, he told his disciples to remit. He says, sis, let's look at it real quick. So we refer to it so it'll be fresh. John 20. Go back to John 20. Now, Jesus had just rose from the grave. His disciples had all just abandoned him. All except John. That's in the series about John. Mm-hmm. All except the disciple John. He first started to abandon him, but he turned around and went back to the cross to die with Christ. Mm-hmm. We'll deal with that later on. But here, these men who abandoned Christ out of being ashamed because he wasn't going to set up this earthly kingdom. They didn't abandon him out of fear. They abandoned him they were ashamed. They were offended. They're like, my king going to just get sacrificed? You know, like that. That's the model. That's why they abandoned him. They didn't abandon him because they were fleeing for their life. They abandoned him out of shame. So these men who definitely had issues, Christ tells them, verse 23, he tells them, whosoever sins ye remit, they are remitted unto them. Now they're still carrying guilt from what they did. And Jesus is telling them about remitting someone else. I said, I had to pause right there. I had to really think about it. Why is that, knowing that they're carrying guilt for what they had just done, why is Jesus telling them to release someone else? About releasing others? And then I saw the beyond brilliance of God. What we just say, how you forgive others is how God forgives you.
Amen.
So how they help release others from bondage or guilt is how God will be willing to release them from what they just abandoned Christ. So Christ is saying, instead of them saying, Jesus, I'm sorry. Jesus said, okay, I'm gonna help you prove it to me by sending you to release others from their guilt that they might have done to you. That's the beyond brilliance of God. He said, I'll truly see if you're sorry. If you can forgive your brother or your sister or your spouse or your child without letting them wobble in their guilt, then I can forgive you, clean slate. Your sins can't be remitted if you don't remit others. Sometimes, because we carry baggage, we want others to do the same. Mercy. Sometimes, because we have guilt from past sins, sometimes we want others to do the same. The devil, but check this out. This struck me when I think about how precious the Holy Spirit is. The devil has cleverly gotten us to equate his beating people over the head with guilt from our past sins as that's the Holy Spirit. Let me explain. The devil has gotten us to believe that when you're still feeling guilty, even though you've asked for forgiveness, God has forgiven you, and you're still beating yourself over the head with this guilt from your past sin, the devil has gotten us to believe that that's the Holy Spirit working on your conscience. When that's really him. He's putting his work on the Holy Spirit. And I say, well, so what's the difference? Because the Holy Spirit does convict you and beat you over the head in your conscience if he has to. This is the difference. The Holy Spirit convicts, which leads us to repentance and forgiveness. Not convicting a person after they repent. The Holy Spirit doesn't beat you over the head after you've repented and you were sincere. He beats you over the head right when you got through doing it. Mm-hmm. He beats you over the head to lead you to repent.
Right.
Not after you repent. That's how you can tell, y'all. I'm telling you. When you go to your day-to-day walk and them old sins pop up in your mind, you might be at work or something, or things of that nature, instead of you feeling guilty, you're like, hold on, I talked to myself, like, hold on, I don't ask forgiveness for that. Let me think on something else. You gotta, once you start to see that, hold on, that's the enemy. Mm-hmm. That's not my father.
Mm-hmm.
Hmm. Why else does the devil warn us? We're gonna look at one more thing. Why else does the devil want us to carry suitcases?
Mm-hmm.
Hmm. As Christians, we are in a race.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
That's right.
Okay, I'm seeing something I already get. Now, that's the question. Why else does the devil want us to carry suitcases?
Mm-hmm.
But as Christians, Christ and Paul says, we are in a race to receive a prize.
Mm-hmm.
Turn to 1 Corinthians. Let's go to 1 Corinthians. 1 Corinthians chapter 9. 1 Corinthians chapter 9. I always wait to tell you the verse so you don't read ahead of me. 1 Corinthians chapter 9. And we're going to look at verse 24. Verse 24. Know ye not that they which run in a race run all, but one receiveth the prize? So run that ye may obtain. Hmm. And what he's saying right here, he says, even though everybody's running in this race, everybody's running, but not everybody's going to win.
Mm-hmm.
But let me ask you this. I'm connect some dots. How fast you think you're going to be carrying suitcases?
Not far.
How fast are you going to be carrying suitcases?
Mm-hmm.
Will you win the prize?
Mm-hmm.
I believe this is the main reason why the devil wants you to carry these suitcases of guilt from past sin. Turn to Philippians. Let's go to Philippians 3. Philippians chapter 3. You know, there's a song by Dara McLean, and she says, you can't run while holding suitcases.
Oh.
You might can run a couple steps, but you're going to get tired after about 5 more steps. And you either just gonna give up altogether. Philippians chapter 3. Chapter 3, and we're going to look at verse 13. And we're going to look at verse 13. Now remember, we're all in a race. We're all in a race. Philippians chapter 3, verse 13 says, brethren, I count not... Now when we read these verses, remember what we just talked about letting go, about remission, wiped clean. Chapter 3, verse 13 says, brethren, I count not myself to have apprehended, but this one thing I do, forgetting. What did he say there?
Forgetting
those things which are behind and reaching forth unto those things which are before. I press toward the mark for the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus.
Amen.
Hmm. Did he just explain remission in practical terms? Forgetting those things which are behind and reaching forth unto those things which are before. Now, I'm going to tell y'all, this is so crucial. It's so crucial to your Christian walk. Those things that we've done in our past are easily grab hold of you. They take the way you look at yourself day to day in the mirror. They take the way you walk, the way you talk, the way you treat others, the way you treat your kids, the relationship with your spouse. That guilt, when you carry it, it'll change your whole lifestyle in a negative way. In a negative way. Ellen White says in the Acts of the Apostles, page 483, the Holy Spirit through Ellen says, he who would build up a strong, some medical character. He who would build a strong character, he who would be a well-balanced Christian, must give all and do all for Christ. For the Redeemer will not accept divided service. Mm. Daily, he must learn the meaning of self-surrender. He must study the Word of God, learning its meaning and obeying its precepts. Thus, he may reach the standard of Christian excellence. That's the aim, is Christian excellence of the race that we're running. But what Paul is saying here, if you don't forget those things that are behind, you'll never reach that aim.
Amen.
Could that be why many Christians feel like they're not going nowhere? Because they're steady trying to run a race, but they're carrying too much baggage. Mm-hmm. Turn to Hebrews. Let's go to Hebrews. Hebrews chapter 12. Hebrews chapter 12. When you get this, say amen.
Amen.
Hebrews chapter 12, and I'm going to read verse 1. It says, wherefore seeing, we let us lay aside every weight mm-hmm. and the sin which doth so easily beset us, and let us run with patience the race that is set before us. Mm. Now, even when he says something, even before he says, before you start running, he says, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which does so easily beset us. Let us run with patience the race that is set before us. In Acts of the Apostles, page 312, the Holy Spirit says, in the epistle to the Hebrews, it's pointed out the single-hearted purpose that should characterize the Christian's race for eternal life. Envy, malice, evil thinking, evil speaking, covetousness, these are weights that the Christian must lay aside if he would run successfully the race of immortality. Every habit or practice that leads into sin and brings dishonor upon Christ must be put away. Whatever the sacrifice, the blessing of heaven cannot attend any man in violating the eternal principles of right. Even envy, malice, evil thinking, evil speaking, covetousness, these are weights that the Christian must lay aside if he would run successfully the race of immortality. You can't run while carrying suitcases. You can't run while carrying suitcases. Let's turn to John. Go back to the book of John, chapter 20. We're going to look at a different verse. Two days after the cross, there was a race that took place. And two people were involved. One carries the title the disciple whom Jesus loved. Now, Jesus loved all his disciples. But it made me go into another study of why did this disciple, John the Beloved, why did he carry the title the disciple whom Jesus loved? And then there was Peter. But let's look at it. John, and I'm going to start at chapter 2. John chapter 20, chapter 20. John chapter 20, but I'm going to start at verse 2. Well, let's start at verse 1. The first day of the week cometh Mary Magdalene early, when it was yet dark, unto the sepulchre, which means grave, and seeth the stone taken away from the grave. Then she runneth and cometh to Simon Peter and to the other disciple whom Jesus loved, and said unto them, they have taken away the Lord out of the sepulchre, and we know not where they have laid him. Peter therefore went forth and that other disciple and came to the grave. Verse 4. So they ran both together, and the other disciple did outrun Peter and came first to the sepulchre. Now, you know, there's no coincidence with God, and God does everything for a reason. Why does God make a point to say who outran who to the grave? Now, I'm telling you for real, this would make me, I always question, and it's good to do that. Everything in this book is for a reason, and for our admonition. My kids run to the car every time when they, for no reason, no reason at all. We just go into Walmart, they racing for no reason. But I'm not gonna tell everybody about it. Yeah, my little one beat Caleb this time going to the car, you know. They don't race any time. So why is God making a point to let us know that John the Beloved outran Peter to the grave? Let's see what. Let's go back. Let's go back 2 days to the cross. Let's go back 2 days to the cross. See if we can find the answer. Here we are. Let's go to when they take Jesus hostage. I say hostage. Let's go back when they grabbed Jesus, took a hold of him in the garden. Peter fled and abandoned Christ. Mm-hmm. While John turned around to go and die with Christ. Mm-hmm. Now I stress that because, like I say, so many other times now, in this series, Monsters in the Closet is dealing with mostly John and Peter. And we're comparing the two. Because most of the time, we do a lot of learning about Peter. And I think in our sinful state, that's who the devil wants us to learn about. But it hit me one day. If I want my kids, say if I want my daughter, if she was playing basketball, and now if I wanted her to be good at basketball, or gymnastics, I said gymnastics, she looked at me crazy. Or gymnastics, I'm not just gonna tell her about that she needs to learn about the girl in gymnastics who failed. I'm gonna pick the one, say like old school Mary Lou Retton, if y'all know who, I don't know, or Dominique Dawes, and I'm gonna teach her about her and say, learn how she flipped, learn how she did this. So it hit me one day, we're always learning about Peter, the one who argued with God, the one who had the audacity, thought he could grab God and rebuke him. We're always learning about him. Why don't we learn about the one who God refers to as the one he loves? Why don't we learn about John the Beloved and try to mirror after John? See, because for my whole life, I always just heard all the disciples fled and left Christ at the cross. And it took upon my own personal study of putting common sense together, 1 + 1 = 2, that John the Beloved started to run, but then stopped and said, you know, I'm going to die with my Savior. But we're not told that. We don't want you to know about John the Beloved and how he turned around to go back to be with Christ and to die with him. He didn't go back just to go back. Remember, back in this day and time, when they took hold of somebody they felt was a problem, they not only killed him, but also his disciples also, fearing that his disciples might start another insurrection or rebellion. So when John went back, John was preparing to die with Christ. And if you read the Desire of Ages, she said he didn't go back for his sake. He went back to comfort Christ. This disciple who was the youngest out of the 12, who was a teenager. You know what made me realize he was a teenager? This way I saw him. You know what made me realize he was a teenager? In reading the book where it says he was leaning on the breast of Christ. In the Last Supper, he was leaning on Christ. And then again, when Jesus appears and after the resurrection, and Jesus comes back and he appears on the shore and they're sitting around eating, it says again, he's leaning on the breast of Christ. That's how I knew he had to be young. That's what made me want to do my study, because I was like, this grown man leaning on another grown man. I thought, that ain't right. No, that ain't right. And that's when I realized John was a teenager. John the Beloved was a teenager. But anyway, the devil doesn't want us to learn about John the Beloved. But we see at the cross. Remember, let's go back. We're talking about suitcases. Uh-huh. We're talking about guilt. Uh-huh. We're talking about but trying to finish the race. Uh-huh. We're talking about a race took place. Uh-huh. Someone lost. Someone won. Uh-huh. Peter fled and abandoned Christ. John turns around and goes to die with Christ. Peter was ashamed of Christ. Like I said earlier, he wasn't afraid to die at the cross. Think about it, a couple hours before, he took out a sword and cut off a man's ear with the soldiers and the mob around him. Peter was ready to squabble with everybody out there. He was not afraid to die. He was ready. That's why he swung first. He was ready. So Peter was not afraid to die. When he denied Christ, because for the longest as a child, I used to think that Peter was afraid to die. And that's why he did it. But Peter did it he was ashamed that the leader that he was following, that his God, would stoop so low. He was like, that's not my God. That's not my master. He did it because he was ashamed of Christ. And I stand to ask, are you ashamed of Christ today? Ask yourself, but be honest. Because if you're not ashamed of him, you would tell everybody about him.
That's right.
You would talk about him when it's not cool. You know? You wouldn't laugh at certain things that you know he hates. And it's hard, y'all. I be at work, I be hearing conversations. Some things actually be funny, and I be trying not to laugh. Like, nah, I'm not even gonna laugh about it. I don't even want people to think I like it. Even though they talking about crazy, outrageous stuff. I'm like, I'm not even gonna laugh. Because I used to. And then I had to catch myself like, wow, they think my laughter is signifying that I agree. So sometimes some people now, my wife would tell you, some people I get stigmatized at work, but I can care less. You know, they know I can care less. But I had to start saying, okay, if it hurts Christ, let me stop acting like it's okay.
Yes.
Let me stop acting like their feelings matter to when it comes to Christ. You know, let them think that JOK Josh just stuck up and quiet, don't want to talk to nobody. That's fine. But I love you, though. You know? You come to me, you need something, I'll talk to you, I'll help you out. But let me start showing people that I'm going to die with my Savior.
Amen.
Peter was ashamed of Christ. While John loved Jesus for who he was. And that's big. That's big. Like I said in part two of this, dealing with Peter, you know, if somebody loves you, there's a difference between someone loving you for what you do and for who you are. I remember when my wife first got together, I said, baby, just learn to love me for who I am. Please just don't love me for what I do. Because when you stop doing, the person stops loving you. And I had to realize many of us only love God for what he does for us. And that's why the minute he stops doing, or it seems like he stops doing, when things aren't going our way, we find it so easily to turn back and go back to certain old ways and habits. Because things ain't going right in our life. That is a sign that you're in love with God only for what he does. Because when you love him for who he is, it's almost like Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, when they said, even if he doesn't save us, even if he does not save us, he's a great God.
Yes.
And that's like saying, you know, like I told my, you know, even if we end up poor, broke, bills getting cut off, like I say, stigmatized at work, got demoted. Even if these things happen, can I still say I serve an awesome God?
Amen.
Can I still tell people about God? That is a sign as if I love him for who he is and not just for what he does. Hey, y'all, tell me, this is all to me. I had to change my prayers. I noticed when I really got deep into this, I noticed even in my prayer that one of the first things I used to say was, Father, thank you for what you do. And I had to catch myself.
Yes.
Like, hold on, no. I said, thank you for who you are.
Yes.
And think about it. Everything God does is wrapped up in who he is.
Yes.
So when you start to love him just for who he is, simply because he's a great God,
yes,
that's what he'll do for you.
Yes.
Oh, man, I'm telling you. Let's look at it like this. You got to look at it in a practical, person-to-person way in relationships. Do you want your children or your spouse to say, baby, I only love you because you pay the bills. You know, how would that make you feel though? You don't feel used, wouldn't you? Let's be honest, you feel used.
Yes.
Like, you only love me because I pay the bills.
Well,
you only love me because I buy you this to take you out. But when your baby say, you know what?
Help us, Lord.
Even though you keep messing up the kitchen, you won't help me with no dishes. I love you, little hard headed stuff.
Well, yeah.
My wife know that that's a personal example with us. You know? I think she had to come to that grips like, why are you helping with no dishes? But I love you for who you are.
Amen.
And that's what God wants us to come when we come with the Lord.
Yes.
To say, Lord, even though things might not fall the way they need to fall, I'm hoping they fall in my life, I love you regardless, and I'm not going to stray.
Yes.
And I'm not going to stray.
Yes.
But right here, what if I told you that was one of the differences between Peter and John? Mm. But that's part two, is that Peter loved God for what he did.
Mm. Mm.
Not for just who he was.
Mm.
That's why it was so easy.
Mm-hmm.
When he saw Christ being taken and beaten and manhandled by the mob, that's why he walked away in disgust. Like, I don't know him.
Mm.
That's exactly, I don't know him.
Mm.
I'm not with him.
Mm.
Why? Because the dreams of his plans of what Christ was gonna do for him had just been canceled.
Mm-hmm.
He thought Christ was gonna set up this earthly kingdom.
Mm-hmm.
And when he saw that no earthly kingdom was gonna set up and he was gonna be one of the generals in the kingdom, he quickly, I don't know him.
Mm-hmm.
Showing that he only loved Christ for what he did. But there was one disciple who loved him for who he was.
Mm-hmm.
Who loved him for who he was.
Mm-hmm.
We'll get back to that. Instead of going to the cross to be broken, Peter wept bitterly in his shame and guilt for what he had done. He wept bitterly. His guilt was weighing him down. While John, on the other hand, had been forgiven, remitted, and received a new life and a new start at the cross. Let's go to John 19. At the cross, John, the beloved, was given a new life and a fresh start. John 19. I'm going to start at verse 26. Say amen if you're there.
Amen.
When Jesus therefore saw his mother and the disciples standing by, whom he loved, he said unto his mother, Woman, behold thy son. Then said he to his disciple, Behold thy mother. And from that hour, that disciple took her into his home. Now, the spiritual significance of this is great. Right here, we see that the disciple, if you look at the verse right before that, there's only certain women at the cross right here. So, you know, the women have been holding up the church for many years. So the men, even the men I see here, you know, I salute you. And I salute the women for also holding up the church, you know. But we see right here, John the Beloved is the only man there at the cross.
Mm-hmm.
And he's a teenager.
Mm-hmm.
But Jesus looks at him and says, Woman, behold thy son. Then he said he to his disciple, Behold thy mother. He's giving. Now you're just not going to give just anybody your mom to look at.
Lord, help us.
So there's a reason why he called John the disciple whom he loves.
Mm-hmm.
Could it be John the beloved was the only one who loved him for who he was?
Mm-hmm.
And given a fresh start. He was given a new mission. Now you know Mary, now the Catholic Church says she was the church things, and it's always be careful how I say this part. But in symbolic spiritual terms, Mary was a representative of the church. That's why it says Christ was born from the woman. You know, in Revelation 12. And that's why she was born a virgin. That's why she was a virgin when she had Christ. So, in essence, when you look at her as, say, signifying the church, when Christ gave her to John to watch over, what was he giving John? He's giving him a mission to watch over my church.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Who was the disciple who watched over the church when all the other disciples were dead and gone?
Mm-hmm.
Was John the beloved.
Mm-hmm.
This young man right here.
Mm-hmm.
He was alive 40 years when all the other disciples were dead and gone and maintained and took care of God's church for 40 years.
Mm-hmm.
when he was, and that's at the end of, close to the end of the 40 years, was when he was given the revelation. That's when Christ came back to him and gave the revelation, what we call the Book of Revelation. And also, and what great gift is this? And like I said, I always be wary of saying that Mary is a representative of the church, because like we said, the devil has taken that and took it to an extreme, calling her the mediatrix and things of that nature. But what great gift. Look at the gift that was just received right here. He got to live with the mother of God. But look at the gift. While he's sitting up late night, now me and my grandma, once my family changed and things of that nature, me and her would sit around the table, be 2 a.m, sipping on stuff we weren't supposed to be sipping on, but it'd just be me and her. And she'd be talking, telling me everything. Scoop about everything. I'm like, my mama did that. She'd tell me everything. You know? Sometimes I used to call my mama, grandma told me. One time I told her, you actually got on me for doing this and you was not doing this. Like, well, I'm gonna talk to your grandma. But anyway, but I picture that with John. Look what great gift he had. He had the chance of the ages to sitting around with Mary late night. And she telling him, yeah, when Jesus was 10 years old, he did this and he did that. And he's getting all of this firsthand. Could that be why he went from the son of thunder to the disciple of love? No one speaks about love in the New Testament more than John the Beloved. He went from this disciple quick, ready to kill off whole towns, and actually prayed, said, Jesus, please, can we kill them all? Can we bring fire down and kill them all? He went from that to the disciple of love. But I'm getting off subject. But we're talking about guilt, suitcases, and running a race. So John at the cross was given a fresh start. He was forgiven. Guilt gone. While Peter was weeping bitterly over his sins. Go to Hebrews 9. Well, I'll just go, you don't even have to turn. Hebrews 9:22 tells us that without the shedding of blood is no remission. That's why Peter still had his guilt, because he wasn't at the place where the blood was being shed. John was right there. Woo-hoo. Can feel the blood, see the blood. He was forgiven. His sins were remitted. But Peter was wallowing in his guilt and his shame. And that's why I said to say to you, how many of you may be wallowing in your guilt and your shame? If I tell you, many years I did in mine. So Peter didn't go to the only place he could receive remission. So 2 days later, when they are running to Christ, weren't they running to the grave? They are running to Christ. The disciple who had no bags to carry, the one who went to Jesus to be completely forgiven, the one who chose to die with Christ and to go to the cross, it was he who won the race. And could it be that's why God made a point to tell us about this little bitty race and made a point to say that it was the disciple whom Jesus loved outran Peter. Because how did that saying go in that song? You can't run when you're holding suitcases. The devil's suitcases. Suitcases of guilt and shame. Let them go. Let them go. And watch how life, you feel that burden just lift off. And be honest. You gotta pack, when you pack on the tree, you gotta be honest about what's in them suitcases. Be honest and let them go. I had to look at my wife and I had to say, baby, I got temper issues. I don't know how to forgive. I had to let them go. Sometimes I look at her and say, baby, that's from your childhood. Let it go.
Yes.
Let them go. You've been forgiven. You have been forgiven. This is a new day. This is part 3 as I close. Let's go over to the next chapter in John 21. I'm going to touch on part 3 John 21, verse 3 and 7. John 21, I'm going to start at verse 3. It says, Simon Peter saith unto them, I go fishing. They say unto him, we also go. Now remember, Peter hasn't been forgiven yet. He's still carrying something. They say unto him, we also go with thee. They went forth and entered into a ship immediately, and that night they caught nothing. But when the morning was now come, Jesus stood on the shore, but the disciples knew not that it was Jesus. Then Jesus said unto them, children, have ye any meat? They answered him, no. And he said unto them, cast the net on the right side of the ship, and ye shall find. They cast therefore, and now they were not able to draw it for the multitude of fishes. Therefore, that disciple whom Jesus loved said unto Peter. Now you see how it's interaction between these two. And not just about these two. I think God wanted us to compare these two. But therefore, that disciple whom Jesus loved said unto Peter, it is the Lord. Now when Simon Peter heard that it was the Lord, he girt his fisher's coat unto him, for he was naked, and did cast himself into the sea. There's so much field right here. I just wanted to touch on it as we end. The one who carried no guilt, the one who followed Christ to the cross, was the one who recognized Jesus.
Amen.
Could it be that when you're also carrying guilt and shame, you don't see Jesus for who he really is? He could be in your life and working, but you don't see him because you're too busy trying to hold on to these suitcases that are getting heavier and heavier. The more you add into them. How come out of all the disciples there, it was John the Beloved who saw him and recognized him? But check it, when you're carrying suitcases and when you're carrying guilt and shame in your life, how did it say Peter was? What was he doing in the boat? How was he in the boat? He was naked. What did Christ say about this naked? Because I believe this is a typology. I believe this is a symbol for our day and time of these two. Where you see, one, you have two disciples. Well, we're just going to talk about these. So you have these two disciples. One sees Christ watching and ready. But one is caught naked and ashamed. Come on with me. We're talking about now. We're talking about getting ready for the second coming. When Christ says, when I come back, watch and be ready. Don't be caught and ashamed. That's Revelations verse 16. So could it be, do we want to just learn about the one who was caught naked and ashamed? Or should we learn about the one who was watching and was ready? Revelation verse 16, and I'm going to read verse 15. And this is the words from Christ. He says, behold, I come as a thief. Blessed is he that watcheth and keepeth his garments, lest he walk naked and they see his shame. Go back to John 21. This is how you know judgment was taking place. Let's say this was a typology for our day and time. John 21. It says, verse 4, but when the morning was now come, who stood on the shore?
Jesus
stood on the shore, but the disciples knew not that it was Jesus. Jesus was investigating. Don't we talk about an investigative judgment? Jesus was standing there investigating, watching, judging. And one of the disciples watched and saw and recognized Christ. And the other one was found to be naked and shamed. One who was carrying suitcases of guilt. Could it be those suitcases also strip you of your righteousness?
Yes, it does. Yes, it does.
And you end up losing the race.
Yes.
I'm telling y'all, I can't even stress it enough. This was to me. To me and my family. For those suitcases was killing us. My wife was holding on to guilt from her past, the mistakes she made, and me, I'm holding on to guilt from her past. It ain't nothing but a house full of old suitcases. A house full of luggage, and Christ couldn't get in.
Hoarders.
I like that. For real, we're hoarders. House full of luggage, and Christ couldn't even get in. She carrying her old suitcases, I'm carrying mine. And look at it like this. If both of us carrying suitcases, How can we hug each other and love each other?
Yes, that's right.
If our hands is on these old suitcases. It was the monster in the closet.
Mm-hmm.
I see why the devil doesn't want remission talk. The wiping away of guilt. But not only do we seek remission from God, but we have to grant it to other people.
Yes.
That's a hard thing to do. It's not easy.
Yes, it is.
But with the Holy Spirit, it's easy. It can be done. And when you grant others remission, you yourself will be remitted. My brother Jeremy passed away June 2nd, 1999, in a car accident. And he was adopted by my godmother. And 3 months before the car accident, he called me up. I just got out of jail. He called me up, and I've been locked up over 23 times. Went to prison when I was 15, sentenced to 3 years. I got picked up by a boy's home after only being in there for 2 weeks because of scoring high on some of the tests. It was nothing but the Lord. But anyway, I just got one of my times I just got out. And this is my younger brother. I call him my baby brother. They were my godmom. I know the boy. I remember when she had adopted him, you know, as a baby. You know, that was my little uncle, but I taught him how to cut his hair. First girlfriend told him how to tell the girls all that, you know, that's my younger brother. So he called me up, he said, "Jay, I'm glad you're out there." I said, "Yes, it feels good to be free." You know, we talking, and he said, "Well, mom wanted us to, wanted me to go to college, to Oakwood." He said, "But I told her I wasn't gonna go unless you come with me." And I told him, I said, "Babe, boy," I said, "man, I ain't even gonna waste nobody's money." I said, "I'm out here in this world. I'm cutting up. I'm doing this and that." I said, "I'm not going." He said, "You sure?" He said, "Come on now." He said, "I told you go if I go." She said she'll get us an apartment and things of that nature. You know, it'd be a fresh start for you. I said, "Nah, I ain't gonna go." I didn't even hesitate. I didn't even think about it. That was our last conversation. Mm-hmm. We were gonna leave a month later. They were all so sure that he could get me to go. And 3 months later, he was coming around the corner, late one night. You know, skidded, lost control, flipped out the car, went through the windshield, died, killed. I carried that guilt with me. I turned into a monster. I carried that suitcase for a long time. Still now, gets at me. And I remember one day, first time my godmom heard me speak, you know, I sat there one day in my room later. That suitcase made me run my life a month. I threw away a lot of years, drowned a lot of tears in bottles because of that one suitcase. Hurt people, came. And I was sitting there, and at my real mom's house, she had a picture of Jeremy with my other brother, Jason. And it hit me. He would be ashamed of how it turned out. And I was letting that guilt of his death take me further and further away from the Lord. So I said, okay. I'm gonna let it be a motivation to change my life and come to the Father. And because I was a bad influence and disregarded so many souls, I'm gonna try to bring as many souls as I can into the kingdom.
Amen. 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 Amen.
And so that's what I did. And it's not been easy, but with God, all things is worth it. You start to fall in love with the Father. And I'm here to tell y'all from personal experience, even just recently to stuff in my personal life, like I said, that was affecting my marriage, affecting my job, how I was acting. I looked and it was suitcases of old pain, old baggage, old guilt. And I'm going to end it because I can keep showing the differences between Peter when at the Last Supper, when John is laying on from the breast of Christ, Peter, because of the guilt and stuff that he had already done, he said, ask him who's going to betray him to John the Beloved. Why couldn't he ask? Why? Because his guilt made him seem like he couldn't come to Christ. Does your guilt have you the way you feel like you can't come to Christ? Like maybe he might hear this person's prayer before he hears yours. It's time to let go of those suitcases, y'all. And run the race. Let them go.
Yeah.
And watch how better you feel in your everyday life. How lighter you feel when you're told. You walk around and you're like, did you just lose weight or something? You're like, yeah, I lost 200 pounds, you know. You never know. Watch how it feels. You never know what God can really do for you.
Amen.
And this is an appeal. And I'm starting with myself. If you want God to help you let go of those suitcases and to start over fresh and new, I ask you to come down here and let's pray together. Amen. Let's hold hands, let's pray together. A new start. Giving us chance after chance to come to you. We thank you, Lord, for not only giving us the chance, Lord, but aiding us in every step of the way, for we couldn't do it on our own, Father. We thank you, Lord, for not only just helping us to overcome sin, but for utterly wiping out the guilt of it, that we may become new creatures, sons and daughters of the kingdom. Help us, Lord, to drop away these weights that hold us down, the thoughts that crowd our hearts and our minds, the regrets that eat away at us at night, in the mornings.
Yes.
Lord, the shame that we carry that makes us look at ourselves in different ways, or the guilt and the shame that makes us even hesitant on coming to you, even questioning your love for us at times. Lord, we thank you, Lord, for helping us get rid of this guilt and this shame, for remitting our souls, giving us remission. And we ask, Lord, that you please help us to remit others. If we're holding anything still on someone else that has wronged us, help us, Lord, to set them free so that you may completely set us free indeed. Lord, we thank you for being present with us today. Be with us throughout the week, Father. Help us, Lord. Continue to help us. Continue to keep your arms wrapped around each and every one of us. You know our needs. You know our desires. We thank you, Lord, for loving us. We thank you for being an awesome and wonderful God. In your Son's precious name.